He's a hustler, unbreakable, a people's person, and a future billionaire. This is The Hustler's Corner with Sbusiso Leope, well known to you and I as DJ Sbu.
Hello guys, welcome to The Hustler's Corner with me, myself, DJ Sbu, straight out of Johannesburg in South Africa. Shout out to all the hustlers that are watching out there, guys. I'd like for you to subscribe to the channel. Click the notification button and click the like button. On the count of three, I want everyone to click the like button. Eh? One, two, three. Click, 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 click. Thank you. Now guys, I'm sitting with somebody whom I've looked up to for many, many years. My mom will tell you, yo, nakabukela uBob Mabena, ungamsukeli loyo. And that is from back in the day. Somebody who's been an amazing broadcaster in the country, media person, media maven, an entrepreneur. A leader, you know, for a lot of us, a role model to many, especially people that are in the media industry, people that love radio, real radio heads. So if you're a real radio head today, and you've probably been following the youth culture in South Africa over the past, what, three decades, you'd know the man. And ladies and gentlemen, welcome Mr. Bob Mabena to the Hustler's Corner. How are you doing, sir?
Good, man. How's it going?
Thank you.
Fantastic.
It means a lot to have you here. I appreciate it.
Pleasure.
Now, the podcast is about inspiring a new generation of young hustlers out there. Right. And obviously, the conversation will be a lot around your story.
Yeah.
Would like to know your story. Would like to know how you got onto the media industry. And I'd like for you to just share with us some of the ups and downs that you've had to go through, some of the people you've met, and some exciting things that have happened in the past. The other day, we were chatting to Penny. Sis Penny Libyan, and she broke it down, the history of where radio comes from.
Yeah.
She broke down how you guys started in Maba, to got Nagotabo Music TV, Bob
yes,
TV,
yes, yes.
Bob Radio,
yep.
Bo Kaya Cool, Bo George Manyosi, how that clan moved. You guys, I think you guys were some of the first guys to move to Metro.
Yeah.
She basically came down with it and she broke it down, even the birth of YFM afterwards,
yeah.
All the way to this multimedia thing that's happening now. Mm-hmm. But it was such a beautiful podcast and it was a great conversation. And I've got no doubt this will be even better.
Cool. Let's do this.
The jammer. Mr. Bob Mabena.
Yes, sir.
Can I hear your story? Where are you from originally?
Well, originally from Ashwichville, west side of Pretoria. One of the smallest townships, growing now, but very small. My parents hail from Limpopo. And they settled from Limpopo looking for work, obviously, in those days in the early 60s. In an area called Marawastat, and then there was forced removals. They moved blacks all the way from Marawastat, put in Indians, and they moved all of them to Atrichville. And in Atrichville, they did a mini Soweto, you know. So there was area ya Materele, area ya Mazulu, area ya Matsonga, area ya Mavenda, you know. And yeah, that's where I'm from. The move was in the early 60s. And I am the third son of the firstborn of that household. My mother's name, Mukhadi. Kasipedi Mukhadi, that's the name you give a girl when she's a firstborn. Because you're validating her.
Kena Khalema. Oh, okay, Mukhadi.
Mukhadi, exactly. Kena Khalema, you know, because back then it was patriarchy. We know the story. I don't have to go into it. So you had to validate the girl child in order for those that come after her to have that respect for Gena Kalima. And did my mother do it? she did. And then she had siblings. I'd never met my grandfather. Apparently he left before I was born.
Mm.
And my father also did the same. So all my cousins and I and everyone else, we lived in this four room house. All 13 of us in that house, that, you know, with a strong matriarch, my grandmother.
I can relate.
Yes, absolutely. We slept under the kitchen.
Yes.
The table kitchen.
The kitchen table.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm told, Kore, when I was a kid, I used to have a corner between Storfo, Dover.
Dover, yeah. Welcome, Dover, baby. Stop some malad.
Exactly. And the grocery cabinet. And I was very overweight.
Okay.
As a kid.
You're a chubby kid.
I was a very chubby kid. And I'm told that my brother used to be the one, there was three of us, my brother in the middle. His job was to carry me from there to the bedroom before Horobaniwa, and then when people had to sleep, he had to pick me up and then put me under the table in the kitchen.
Yeah.
So one day, he really got tired of it.
Yeah.
So I bought me a box of tomatoes on the set because I used to fish. And that's how I got the scar. I'm not quite sure on the side. And you know, there was a speaking irida, you know, it was sticking out and, you know.
Hey, shit.
So obviously got the beating of his life.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's where I come from. Atwitsville, Mahlanye.
So it's a gas.
Gas is straight.
How did you get into, okay, before I even get into broadcasting, education, Skela?
Skela, all township schools. My first primary in Ilikabo, lower primary. And then I went to a school. Fantastic principal, Principal Mboweni, Principal Mgula rather, Ko Mboweni. And then there was a school that had a mix of, you know, back then things were really horrible. The way they categorized people was really horrible.
And then I got apartheid.
Yeah, it was really bad. I mean, that school was called initially Batswadi. It's like all the girls who had kids were taken
Batswadi.
To that school. Mm. And it was closer to where I was adopted after my mother passed away by my uncle. So they took me to that school, Solrich High School. And it turned out to be the best experience of my life. That high school was really fantastic. That's when, because I was a very reserved kid. I was one of those kids who was never seen, like very quiet. I didn't say anything and I had horrible asthma. So I couldn't play outside in the dust. I couldn't play on the lawn. I used to, you know, there was a time when the asthma pump was like an extension of my hand, you know. And Solrich is where I really became seen, so to speak, actually in the last 2 years of school. To the extent that even now, the guys where I grew up in my area, they ask me, which one were you? Because I was just one of those negligible kids who was never really noticed, you know. Yeah.
Singamlo Stavitz guy.
TV.
Because you're one of the people that spoke very good English, kana kutsela tsa apartheid, because nobody could speak good English those days.
It was TV. It really was TV. And towards high school, I used to listen to 702 music when there were music back then. And my mother, bless her soul, you know, before she passed on, she preached reading like nobody's business, you know. But one of the things that she said to me was, you know, it doesn't matter what the language is, whether it's English or Afrikaans or Sepedi. Or Tsonga. When you decide to speak a language, any language, speak it well. You know, she didn't care.
She was strict.
So
no?
Yeah, very, very strict. You know, as a result, any book, if she knocked off from work and I wasn't reading, it didn't matter what time she came from work. If I didn't have a book on me, yeah, no nyewa.
Yeah.
She was very physical.
Oh, that's why you like Tupac, because you could relate to Tupac's story.
Absolutely. Read, and read some more.
For youngsters who don't know, Tupac Shakur's mother, may her soul rest in peace, Mama Afeni Shakur, used to punish him by forcing him to read the newspaper from front page to the back page, njalo nje, and then question him about whatever he was reading about.
that was it. And you know, she didn't care. I remember there was a magazine called Scope back then. It was a skin trade magazine.
Okay.
And they used to have stars on the boobies.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And she didn't care. She would throw that book at me, you know. And I would have to read and then regurgitate what I read. She was very strict when it came to education. I never missed a day in school. She always made sure. There was never a time when I had shabby uniform. School education was very, very important to me. Mm-hmm. I mean, I lost it when I was 10 years old, and my mother took over, from there.
Okay.
And she actually later on told me that one of the last conversations that she had with my mother was my mother making her promise that she'll take care of me as the last born of the family.
Mm.
Because 2 months before she died, my brother passed away as well.
Oh.
So it was one of those really, really bad situations where my mother was like, you know, I'm told clinically she died of cirrhosis of the liver, but I can deduce that she actually died of a broken heart, you know. So she had that conversation, luckily enough for me, with my mother to say, that one, you need to focus on her. And that's what my grandmother did. She just took over. So in essence, I can say there is no single man who had an influence on me while I was growing up, except for my brother.
So you didn't have that much of a father figure?
No, not at all.
Broadcasting?
Broadcasting was a, you know, radio and TV for me, there was a time when I was considered a lazy bugger, because when I was adopted by my uncle, illness is something that was not understood back then. I mean, it was the 70s and 80s. Asthma, they even mistaken it for something like headlining.
Yeah.
And they didn't really understand it. And I couldn't lift anything. When they were doing spring cleaning, I could, because of the dust and everything. So it was like, that one is lazy. Mm-hmm. Just sits there. So they would plunk me in front of the TV and the radio, and that would be it. And then I started listening to 702, and man, I listened to John Berg's, Rob Wheatley, Koki Tubu, Tota Lemajwe, and those guys were like, I want to be like these guys. And then when Metro started, I was like, yes, please. Tim moved over from Radio Bop to Metro. And then there was...
I think I wonder what I'm trying to find out. What was your first break? Because I can imagine those apartheid days were difficult to get on.
It was because listening to these guys, you convince yourself, because you're rehearsing by yourself in your room.
Yeah.
Not room, in your corner.
Yeah. You don't even have a room. Yeah.
I sent demo tapes. I used their Tempest,
yeah.
Those tape decks, still it's how you press pause and then play and record. And I sent the demo tape to what was then Radio 5. I sent to Radio Bop as well. And I got rejected outright. And then during the trick, there was one nightclub in Atteridgeville called Serama. And Sekgale Mohotsi, bless his soul.
And so rest in peace. Yeah.
Used to come through, to the club. And he said, look, man, you're really good at this mixing thing. I've never seen, because Kokasinele, you put the needle, the record plays and it ends, And I had learned how to mix. And he was like, let's make a deal. You teach me how to mix and I'll get your foot in the door, Radio Bop. I was like, whatever. I didn't believe him.
This is Mr. Mkhalibohot.
Yes. I didn't believe him. I was like, whatever,
Yeah.
So I taught him how to mix anyway. And as well as I do, if you're not tone deaf, you can learn how to mix in a week.
Yeah.
All you have to know is the beats and everything and where to mix and how to mix. And then after matric, he said, I'm keeping my promise because I promised you. Got to Bob. He trained me after hours. Like, he used to sneak me in and show me how the board works and everything, how to cut a promo on a quarter inch, what a cartridge was, the microphone technique, everything. I mean, and it was amazing because he did all of this illegally. So he just sneaked me into the building.
So he liked you.
Bophuthatswana, it was very tight.
Yeah, exactly.
And one day as I was hanging around, because I used to audition, so every other month they would have auditions for overnights. I mean, at that stage, it was even nice because Zandi Lenzalo was on, Bendy Gobe was on, and they were all my age group. And I was like, but But I was a little bit awkward, I was, I had a secret, Tall, skinny, lanky, torn jeans, And one day, one of the afternoon drive guys had an altercation with the station manager. And they didn't want to move the musical chairs. Like, and then one guy said, but there's a guy, man, because I never left. I used to be at reception almost every day.
Sure.
Keep it in me, really, honestly. And they were like, this is your last chance. And when they auditioned me, they put me in a production studio. And I think it was a setup because they really wanted to get rid of me. But it didn't work because all they had in there was Johnny Hodges, Sonny Stitt, Johnny Coltrane. They had only jazz albums, the records.
Yeah.
And at my age, they thought, he's never going to be able to break announce this stuff. Unfortunately for them, jazz was my thing. I mean, I grew up listening to jazz.
Yeah.
So I killed it and I got the job immediately.
Wow.
On the afternoon drive. So it was a...
So you want afternoon drive immediately?
Yeah.
You want drive immediately?
Straight on to drive immediately.
Ew.
Yeah. I mean, they gave me a car and everything. We're like, go, and a driver. Go to Atteridgeville, pick up whatever's yours and come back the next day. So, and I was on air in 2 days.
That is incredible. For those who don't know, Mr. Mabena became one of the biggest household names in this country has ever had. When you talk about somebody whose career is at its peak and he's so famous that he's known by everyone, he's on television prime time, he's on radio prime time, he's on Metro, he's doing prime time shows. He's got music albums, he's got hit songs. He's literally everywhere. And for me, I'm just I didn't even know that Mr. Sekgale Mokgotsi put him on.
Yep.
You see, these are the type of stories that I want to listen to.
I lived at his house, actually, before I got the gig. I lived with him and his mother and his siblings for about 5 months or so, you know. Some days would be so tough, we'd be eating papaka, mayonnaise,
Ish.
You know. Hmm. But the essence of it was really fantastic because through time, I got to find out that we were actually related long distance through his mother. You know, his mother had a Mabena kind of connection down the line, which, you know, when life is meant to be a certain way, it will be, you know?
But what I've just said, this is what he's saying, it's prior to him becoming that big. He became big when he came to Joburg. Now, they moved to Joburg.
Yeah.
What inspired you? Because I'm figuring as a kid who's probably supposed to be scared of going to Joburg. But you came to Joburg and you even became bigger.
I didn't want to. And the reason for it is that life in Bop was so comfortable. I mean, when have you heard of a broadcaster giving presenters a place to stay and company cars? We had company cars.
Wow.
The Jetta at that time, you know? Yeah. And I think we were paying a premium of about 30 rand, a 3-bedroom. I shared a flat with Glenn Lewis, as a natural.
Yeah, he did tell me that
flat
story.
Flat 38.
I was interviewing him the other day. So that was flat 38.
Flat 38. Okay. A lot of things happened there, you know? But my girlfriend at the time, Zanile Nzalo, called Koos Radebe.
Yeah.
And, you know, she just wanted out. I mean, she had been there before me, so she had been there longer. And Koos said, oh, thank you very much for calling. Do you have Bob's numbers? You know, and, you know, because she was my girlfriend, she's like, hey, look, I wanted to go there, but they don't want me, they want you. I was like, hey, Akira.
Also, the relationship started when you guys were still at Bob.
Yes, I thought you guys
only started changing.
No. We started going out back then.
So they had a celebrity relationship. One of the Beyonce and Jay-Z type of things from back in the day. Sure.
It took a while for me to make the call. I was very comfortable. I mean, Bob was at that time a very small place. Everybody knew everybody. It was friendly. It was safe. And everything was within reach. You know, there was... the mall was over here, the broadcasting center was over there, and the flats were over here. And then every once a week or so, we drive to Gemina, you know, to have our fun. And then we go back, you know. So I was very comfortable, and she pushed me. She really, really pushed me. She's like, you know what? This thing is going to end here, and you don't want to be here when it does. Because your talent is immense. This place is too small for you. So when I finally agreed to a meeting with Koos Radebe at the time, we met actually at the Holiday Inn by Mill Park.
Those are the guys who started Metro FM.
Yes.
At the time
indeed.
It was Radio Metro.
Yes, yes.
So I think he was a station manager or something.
He was station manager at the time. And we had our meeting, and I remember my first salary was about 5,000 rand a month.
Wow, that's a lot of money. those days.
And straight on to my first show, was on a Saturday, the Countdown, and I did that show for the longest time. And then I did Afternoon Drive. Top 40, It was fantastic. I really, even today, you know, if I had to tell you the shows that I enjoyed, that show was one of them because I really made it. I owned it. I made it my own. And as a matter of fact, some stage, the company took me to London, my first overseas trip. For the Dangerous Tour, Michael Jackson Dangerous Tour, you know, and Lawrence Dube was a legend of note, was on Breakfast.
Yeah.
Before then, Tim Wudise was doing the show that I had done, but Tim moved to 702 and I took on that slot. He did, actually before he moved on to 702, that's when talk started on Metro with the Jungle Fever. He had a one or two hour slot at that time. There was no talk on Metro. Tim Wudise started talk on Metro.
Oh, wow.
Yes, yes. Okay. So I would knock off.
That was before he moved to 702.
Before he moved to 702, okay. Yeah. So Metro had, the first talk show host on Metro was Tim Wudise.
Okay.
And he came on after the drive. Tim left, and then Lawrence and I had a discussion, you know. Lawrence was getting on, and he was like, man, I'd like to try Afternoon Drive. Can we swap, you know? And then I went on Breakfast. And that was, Metro was fantastic, man. I mean, the fan base increased tremendously. I remember there was a place called The Ace. I don't know if it still exists, in Durban, not too far from the hostels. We had an OB there, an outside broadcast. I had bought this t-shirt in London, had all the M's. Marcus Garvey, Mandela.
Oh, yeah.
Who else was there? It escapes me now. Martin Luther King.
Yeah.
All the M's. By the time I got from the OB event to the stage, the t-shirt was gone.
I guess that's when you realized how famous you were.
You know what I mean? It was like, what the hell?
My life has just changed.
My watch was gone. My wallet was gone. Fortunately, I got back my wallet with the money in it. I got back my watch, but not the t-shirt, not the cap.
Yeah, yeah.
A few weeks later, that t-shirt was all over the place. This was $70. So, yeah, you know, they duplicate fast.
They love, you know, also.
Yeah, so, you know, Stimela was there as well, performing. It was one of the best moments I've ever had, you know, in KZN. It was the humility of people in that area, because you hear things at that time. I was young, you know, all those things. And, you know,
rest in peace, Ndozi. But, you know, that was a famous story.
It was incredible. The Metro years were really quite exciting. I got to travel a lot. I got to meet a lot of people. I got to do Studio Mix while I was
Studio Mix. Let's talk about Studio Mix. Guys, Studio Mix was like the primetime music show on a Friday night in South Africa. There was no social media, so everybody watched Studio Mix.
Yep. It was, you know...
It was you and Melanie Sun.
Well, hold on. Before Melanie Sun, I actually co-presented with Queen from Generations.
Oh!
Yes.
Mrs. Sofundaba.
Yes, she did Studio Mix for a couple of weeks.
Oh, I didn't know. A little known fact.
Yes.
Okay.
She did, you know, when they were trying to find... Because Melanie was working in the background, you know. And I don't know how the story goes, but I think... Karen Vundla looked around and thought, you know what, I've got to mix this guy with someone
name,
else.
Karen Vundla. Oh,
yeah,
wow.
So she was the exec on Studio Mix. And then I got together with Melanie and we made a great threesome because, you know, I was fantastic friends with Melanie, and then I did an album with Dog Time. They were going out at the time.
Yes, so we used to
have a lot of fun together in Melville. I mean, back then for South Africans, you would
Melville
know my age, you would
place.
Know Melville was the place. If you've been to London, you know, there's a place called Soho. If you've been to the US, you know certain places in LA where it actually looks like the night does not end.
Yeah.
You know, it's almost like fun around the clock. So I got to do a lot of...
And Yeovil was the same, no?
Yeovil was
Yeovil and
exactly
Melville,
the
yeah.
same. And I mean, I even owned the club at some stage.
Yeah, I remember
in Yeovil as well. So had a lot of fun. And then came YFM. You know, and I remember I had a tiff with everybody at YFM as one man. Yes.
No, you were not at YFM.
No. I wasn't at YFM, but I had a tiff with the guys at YFM.
Oh, okay. Oh, when YFM was born.
YFM was born.
Because I joined it later.
Yeah, you came in later.
I was not one of the guys who started with. I came after.
So, I was thinking about, you know, my black consciousness was saying, here are all these white radio stations that are making a whole lot of money.
Yeah.
And you have black stations fighting for their own corner. But there are black people listening to these white radio stations. Why don't, in one way or another, black radio stations collaborate? Because the pie is big enough.
Mm.
So I used the dentures and diapers analogy. I said, you know, Kaya is for people with dentures, and Y is for people with diapers. Someone heard it and he misinterpreted the whole thing. And, you know, I remember even on air, Bankrawaloza, you know?
Yeah.
And then Oskido was like, no, man. Because Oskido was a big buddy of mine. You know, he's like, no, we have to straighten this out. He called me on his show and we straightened it out, you know? Yeah, it was a tumultuous time. Very, very energetic time. And the country was changing. The boomshakas were coming in. I mean, Tebe's first performance was opening for me.
Wow.
In the Val. And it was incredible, man. That's exactly what happened, actually. They didn't know who he was. He came on stage, you know, and you know, when you're first coming on, you're not too sure. And I didn't care for fun. And I had to go on stage and plead on his behalf to say, give this young man a break, you know. I was performing with Doctor at the time. So it was really quite fantastic. I mean, Get Funky became... like an anthem of sorts.
I think you guys never thought that song would be that big, eh?
No.
How was the recording process? I'm sure you guys were just having fun.
I said it, you know, during interviews that, guys, you know, this was just guys in the studio having fun. There was no, like, it's got to be lyrically this or anything. There was none of that. It was all, let's go in there, let's have fun. It was Lindelani's crazy idea.
Yeah.
And it was supposed to be just one thing.
Doctor was big at the time. You were big at the time.
Exactly.
So he's like two huge stars in the country. Soccer player. And how do I equate it? Like Lodge right now and maybe a big artist like Casper Nyoves.
Yep.
They combine, they do a song. Same concept that TKZ did later after Indeed. They did.
Yep.
They did it, TKZ with Benny.
With Benny McCarthy, yeah, yes.
That was also
yes.
big.
Yep.
And you guys mess around and then this song becomes huge.
Exactly.
It now was you have crazy. To be on the mic on stage.
Yeah, no, it was, oh man, it was crazy. And you know, Doctor's playful on stage. They're always playful on stage. So it was a fun thing that happened. And one other thing, since I have the opportunity now to correct people,
yeah.
the summer award that I won was not for Get Funky.
Oh, that was not for Get Funky?
No, no, it was, oh. I was nominated for Get Funky.
Okay.
And another hip-hop group won. It was a white hip-hop group, I can't remember their name.
Okay.
It was a reprise album that I did with, it was an EP actually. Because I, you know, it was one of those, you always want album.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I said, okay, let me do remixes.
And this was a deal with who? Sony?
With Universal.
Universal, okay.
So let me do a deal. Let me do remixes and add one more track.
Okay.
One new track. And I wrote, produced, and rapped on that track on my own. And that's the track that won the Summer Award. It's called The Bomb, you know?
Oh, I don't know it.
It got a lot of airplay more overseas than in this country. You know, it was a very, it was a hardcore, like, I had to sit down and write.
And rap, yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Wow. Yeah.
But then you also had other hits, because I remember you, I think you had a hit with Wendim Seleku or something.
Yes, yes, yes. We did a lot with Wendim Seleku, Margaret Mutsake, and also with Tukulo.
Yes, Magesh.
The telephone song, you know, we did the telephone song with Magesh. The video was fun to make. He was good fun. He was really incredible. Worked with Marvin Moses, worked with Christos as well. It was, yeah, the music thing, I really enjoyed it. I mean, six albums later, you know what I mean?
You did six albums?
Yeah, six albums.
Wow.
Yep.
So he was hot in music, he was hot on TV, he was hot on radio, he was mixing, DJing all over the country, he was on air, and at the same time, he was emceeing gigs, he was a smart dresser, he was the ladies' man, because ladies love the jam. It's crazy for me to get into your mindset, because I've experienced something similar. You know, you've always been my role model. I've always told you this.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And just how my story has always unfolded. I've always just looked at your story. So everything you've been through, I've gone through the same thing. I've got seven albums. And I know just being in that mist of being famous, and your life has just changed. You're on radio, on TV, music is doing well, you've got hit records, you're all of a sudden rolling with celebrities, yep. and you are not just an ordinary DJ, you're like the big dog, like you're at the top, you know guys, when they're talking A-class, that's Bob Mabena, and it's amazing how you are still in the industry today, doing what you love. How do you have the staying power? How do you maintain a career for so long, when you and I both know that a lot of people, it's just again a puma, you know?
It's, you gotta make the mistakes. I mean, one of the mistakes I made was to agree to be a professional racing driver.
Oh, I remember that. I forgot about that. Because he was a trendsetter. Like, he was doing things that nobody was thinking of. He was a professional racing driver. I forgot about that.
That was a mistake. You know, it's a very insular, I think it still is to a very large extent. People in that community keep to themselves. And when you're an outsider, you get treated like an outsider. And when Nissan wanted a BEE, transformation, employment equity kind of guy, they went to Metro and they said, look, just give us one guy. They didn't look for me. They just went to the space manager and say, give us one guy, you know, and Koos Radebe was like, the guy who's doing my drive show, that's the guy, because then we'll get more mileage from it. We'll get, you know, I should have said no at the time, but I didn't know what actually happens within that. You know, you have to be, before a race, you have to be there for the rest of the week. When you knock off,
sure.
you're doing your practice rounds. And then Thursday, Friday, and the day of the race, on Thursday, you do familiarity with the track. On Friday, you do your position. And then on Saturday is the race, you know. And I wasn't really committed to it. It was just something that my station manager thought I should do. And having made that mistake, it was a very expensive mistake. I totaled a car that was worth about 500,000 rand at that time. Oh. I mean, I went off on a hairpin bend at about 210 kilometers per hour. And, you know, it's a costly mistake to make. But it taught me that, you know, focus beats anything else. Just stick to what you're good at. If you're doing other things on the side, just make sure that you give them, you don't give them as much time as you give the main gig. The main gig remains the main gig.
Hustlers, I hope you're listening. Hustlers, you're listening, yeah?
Absolutely, not the springboard. You don't treat the main gig as a passageway. The main thing must always be the main thing. If something on the side comes, consider your time, consider what it's going to do, if it's going to disturb the main gig. Sure, do other stuff. But that was the mistake I did with racing. And I think sustainability of my career was helped by the fact that I made my mistakes earlier on in life. I mean, think about it. I went on air when I was 19, you know. So a lot of the stuff that happened, the huge success and everything happened earlier on in life.
In your 20s,
so I could make my mistakes and they were not too pronounced because it was, fucking Dwyer, you know, he'll make mistakes, the folly of youth, so to speak. So I think that's what has sustained me throughout the years, that I made some serious, serious errors. Getting married, I mean, I don't regret marrying the woman that I married, but it was too early to get married. The career was like flying and all of that, you know. Given the opportunity, I'd do it a bit later, you know. So yeah, I think being cognizant of the main thing being the main thing, and realizing that mistakes are a learning curve, that is what's that sustained.
But I think another thing as well is, and I realized it because I was one of, let me say, the biggest fan till today. You moved with your audiences.
Yes.
That really happens nowadays. Like, wherever you moved, we moved with you. I was not I remember at some point I was not a Kai FM listener. Because at the time, Kai FM was like seen as an older station.
Yeah, senior citizen.
Yes. You know, joke around and say that. But you were one of the few cool guys that came on Kaya. You did Kaya Breakfast and everybody followed you. Because I remember we followed you and we never used to listen to Kaya FM.
Yeah.
But everywhere you went, you've always moved with your audiences. I think till today,
it
your
was
audiences
strange.
Have grown with you.
It was strange because when I left Metro, I went to Haifa. You know, and it was again one of those moments where I was in no man's land.
Let me say this again. He was one of the first, I think he was the first black guy to join Highfield.
Yes.
It was not what it is right now. Guys, I have to keep on coming in and disturbing. I'm giving context.
Yes.
So you understand that it was not just this normal thing where black people work at Highfield. No black person would work at Highfield at that time. He was the first black guy, guys. And that was groundbreaking. That's what I was saying. He was a trendsetter.
It was crazy. Black people called me a sellout. And white people called me a kafir. So it was also a very sad time for me because I found myself not belonging anywhere. And I had a fantastic coach, a guy from Australia, who then said, you know, actually there were two coaches, one guy from Australia, another one from LA, Paul Ward. And Paul said, you know, there's really no big difference with audiences.
Excuse me, yeah.
You want to endear yourself to the audience because you have to. I mean, if you're on air on a radio station and the listeners don't like you, there is a problem. So the listeners actually have to like you. Pick a universal problem that you have and then people will identify with you. It's as easy as that. Wear your heart on your sleeve just a little bit and boom, that was it. I went on air. There was this lady, I keep forgetting her name. Man, she used to call me every time an R&B song played because before then, Highfield was a pure white, like Saki Saki, before Prime Media bought that radio station. So because I was there, they were starting to play Bob Marley, they were starting to play Tony Braxton and Michael Jackson. And those songs settled on that radio station. But because I was on air, the perception was that, yeah, now he's bringing his black artist. And I found the music there, you know? So every time I was on, this woman would call and swear at me and all that, you know? So because of Paul Ward, then I had to identify one thing that is universal, that is a challenge. And at that time, I was a chain smoker. So I decided to talk about the fact that I wanted to quit smoking. All of a sudden, color disappeared. The same woman who was calling called and said, you know what, I have the same problem as well, you know? So that trick worked. And it was quite something else to take it a step further because now I had to assimilate, you know? I had to go to the keg, you know these things, the places that they have, the keg and hog, the whatever. Man, I had to go to those places. It was stressful. But I had to do it because it was a fantastic challenge for me. I had done the audience, you know, I had done youth and contemporary radio on Radio Bop. I had done youth and contemporary on Metro.
Yeah.
I needed a different challenge altogether. And I must say, by the time I left Metro, I had done Afternoon Drive and Morning Drive, and The Countdown. It's three of the most coveted shows. So I was like, after this, what else is there? There was nothing else, you know? So the challenge at Highfield for me was very attractive. And when I did it, it was a challenge indeed, but at least I prevailed, you know? Daytime audience was great. I did a midday slot. Then I went to Kaya, and then there was problems at Kaya. Then I went back and did Afternoon Drive, you know, which made me the first black guy to do Afternoon Drive on Highfield. Fantastic challenge. I was familiar with the audience. It was really fantastic. But at the same time, I was starting to learn about radio.
Guys, did you hear what he said? He left Highfield. There was a time when you did this on a radio station.
Yes.
I think you left one station, you went to another, you came back to this one, and then you came back to the other one. What stations were those?
Yes. It was between Kaya and Highfield.
That's how much he was in demand. Kaya and Highfield.
It was Kaya and Highfield, yeah.
What had happened there?
Well, at Kaya, what had happened was there was a problem with the shareholders. You know, there was a deal that was supposed to happen and it didn't happen. But everybody had their hands on deck. So Stan Cares, the guy who recruited me, he was with Prime Media at the time, one of my mentors. Crazy,
amazing,
crazy,
radio
crazy guy. He's, for me, he's like the rock star of radio for me, you know? Taught me almost everything that I know about radio. He had made a deal with Tebe that he would be the minority shareholder, but he was kicked out unceremoniously. So, and he was heading sales and marketing.
Mm.
I was program manager and also doing breakfast. So at this meeting where he was told to F off, he left with the whole sales team and the whole marketing team. Like, he left the boardroom to the station, told everybody to pack their laptops and everything, and left on the same day. And he was the station manager. So for about 7 months or so, I did five things at Kaya. I was the station manager, program manager, marketing manager, sales manager, and doing breakfast as well for 5 to 6 months.
Oh.
And in a crazy way, it helped because at that time, I was getting divorced. So I used to sometimes sleep at work and, you know, just go to the gym for a shower. And so I had the time to pour all my energy into this.
And I wanted to ask that, like, in the industry, because, okay, you're driving to a point, I'll come in afterwards. Sorry, guys, I've been reading some of your comments from previous shows. You said, when somebody's driving to a point, don't disturb them. I won't.
But, you know, so when they finally got their act together, I was hoping to be GM of that radio station. And then they brought Charlene Deacon in.
I remember Charlene Deacon.
Clearly, I'm not needed here. And I left, I went back to Highfield, where I was on the Afternoon Drive show. And then after that, again, I have a low threshold for boredom. And fortunately, whichever way you want to cut it, you know, there was a time when Highfield did sweeps, like 30 music of uninterrupted music, that kind of stuff. And, you know, all you did was press a button, one link, two links per hour. I mean, I could actually do my links for the whole week, because on the clock it was o'clock to 20 past, you do your link, and then you sweep all the way to 22 and then o'clock. So it was three links per hour, and I had a 3 hour show. So three times three, there you go. That was my links. And your links were also limited to about 10 seconds or 15 seconds. So it was link, I got bored, and I went to the chairman. I said, look, dude. He said, okay, what do you want? I said, I want to be program manager. And he made me program manager. Within 2 months, there was shifts and movements. They bought Cape Talk at Prime Media. They made me station manager of 94.7. And then but after a year or so, I got called back to Kaya. And I was like, okay, it's time to be with my people now, you know, because hey, the rock and roll and the pop was getting to me, you know. In the end, you'll always be who you are.
Yeah,
you know,
music.
What I mean?
Yeah.
So I went there, I went back to Kaya. So that was the to and fro. And it was really fantastic going back to Kaya, because the music format had changed somewhat.
You missed it. Yeah.
It was really, and I missed being with my people, you know what I mean?
Mm.
And then I decided, nah, you know what, actually maybe I should just kill this radio live thing and go into management. Went back to Prime Media. But this time I was at group, doing group sales. So I did dabble into sales, radio sales as well.
Then you came back to the SABC. At some point, you were group.
Yes.
I don't know. You were running multiple radio stations. Yes, the time.
I was a group head MD of Five Metro and Good Hope.
How do you do that?
Man,
I mean, those responsibilities, because I know it's not easy to even work with egos, you know,
and
to manage radio stations.
The hardest thing, though, was taking over after Randall, you know, because Randall is the guy that really did that shift thing to his credit with Fresh, you know, on Five. It was really quite fantastic, and also bringing in Gareth Cliff as well.
It was Randall who brought in Fresh. Because,
yes,
by the way, guys, Randall was our station manager at YFM. Mm-hmm. Before you guys knew him from Idols, he was a YFM station manager. So when I was hired at Y, Randall was our boss.
Yes, and Randall and I share a birthday, 26 July.
Oh, okay.
You know,
yeah.
Really, he's quite a fantastic guy. So it was a challenge to come up at that level, because all he had to do was make the shift, and I had to maintain. And I did that job for about 2 years. And then after that, I was recruited by Fanny Titi, the current chairman of Investec, to run his two radio stations, Gagasi and Heart. So I left and I stayed in the coast for about a year and a bit. And I ran Gagasi and as an MD, Gagasi and Heart. It's very challenging. Different mindset altogether. I mean, I remember landing in Cape Town on an early flight at about 7 o'clock, and there was no one.
Yeah.
Just the DJ and eight.
And that's a different
okay,
culture.
People are gonna come now.
Joburg, it's already on the
nine,
moon at the time, yeah.
10, 10:30, people are coming in. I was, yo, it was a culture shock of like, those people are so chill, dog. And Durban is just so raw and gritty. You know, made friends with Max, of Max's lifestyle. Really quite fantastic place. I mean, I'm glad of what he's made of that place now. And I really enjoyed myself in the coast. The only challenge with that was that, you know, there would be a time where I wouldn't know where I was. Like, you wake up and am I in Cape Town or am I in Durban? Because head office was in Sandton.
Mm.
But it was really fantastic having experienced that whole SABC big Titanic to handling two great coastal radio stations, which had a different impetus altogether. And then going back on air at Kaya when they were in Newtown, which was under Greg Maloka.
And shout outs to Greg. I always give him his props every time I see him. Thank you for believing in me and giving me that break. I don't even know what you saw in me. I don't even know. You saw in me what I didn't even see.
He's got an eye for talent, Greg.
Amazing.
He really does.
Yeah, totally amazing. So thank you. I always shout him out. Radio Today.
Look, it's changed. I have a line that I use with my kids, with any workshop that I do. Whatever doesn't change perishes, right? It does. You know, everything changes. Everything from the water we drink to climate to the way we grow up, the way we're raised.
Culture.
Everything. Culture. You know, all the cultures that resist change actually die.
Yeah.
You know, everything else. So radio has changed, I believe. You know, radio has always had this funny thing of being a great medium. And then it sets the trend and then elasticize.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, other media types have taken. It's always been like that. I mean, in the 70s, with the advent of television, there was like, oh, television is here now. You're not only going to hear people, you're going to see people. So it's the death of radio. Radio slacked, but it made a resurgence because it can now live within TV. And then came the Sony Walkman. So I thought, oh, now I can take my music with me. Yeah, I don't have to play the record, you know?
Yeah.
I can actually put in this thing and in my ears and roller skates and everything, or BMX, you know? Oh, music is portable now, so I don't need the DJ. Radio slacked, and then it came back again.
Mm.
Because now you could record your favorite shows or podcasts.
Yeah.
We've been doing podcasts for the longest time, you know? On a TDK tape. And then came the World Wide Web. Oh, now I can stream TV, I can do whatever. Ah, radio's dead. Radio slacked, and it came back again. Now there's all sorts of influences now that have influenced radio. But it is such a resilient medium that it will always survive every knock. The only unfortunate thing about radio is that there is a resistance to change to a very large extent because people get comfortable with where it's at now. There is no new innovation in radio. It's just other media types being chained onto radio now that makes it more accessible, more exciting. Radio is now visual. Radio can now be time shifted. You can listen to any breakfast show now at any given time, you know, with podcasting and everything. But it's gone very experimental in terms of what the movies have done. You know, you get a J-Lo who was Janet Jackson's choreographer to be in a movie. All of a sudden you've got this following at box office, it becomes a hit. She was never really originally an actress.
Yeah, and people don't
but
know
she did
that
a good
too.
Job. Mm. Exactly. And that's what's happened since.
Guys, go watch a music video of a song by Janet Jackson, That's the Way Love Goes. See Janet Jackson, see J-Lo as Janet Jackson's dancer.
Yep, exactly. Yeah. She was never an actress, but a name can pull an audience. The only challenge is that you can put a name there, but for goodness sake, train them. The basics. You know my favorite line, you know, you got to know the rules first before you break them.
Yes, sir.
But if people don't know the rules and they break the rules, it's like plus 10 minus 10, you get zero. You know, I find that a lot of program managers find the talent, but they don't stretch them and teach them about the basics. Don't crush the vocals. There are certain songs you need to know, which are nice at the end. There's always like that little piano at the end that people know. You talk over that stuff. You know what I mean? Don't go from a song to commercials. All those basics are not to be strict or restrictive. They just make things have shape and order, because radio is by appointment. You know, when you hear a traffic update in the 7 o'clock hour, you should be at the corner of whatever and whatever. You know, when it's o'clock and that thing at the news comes on, you should be at a certain spot. You know, when this feature plays, you should be in the basement parking, and you know you're going to be late because you're listening to that feature.
And when on the other end there's a joke, you want to keep them in the car.
Exactly. I mean, you know, and I think also you actually were part of the problem, because when you came up with Nzegazek, the character
Zayce, thing, I hope he's watching.
The character thing had lost its luster.
Yeah.
Because the character thing was pretty much a guy that you didn't know. It was, but Nzegazeka was a guy you know, you knew. There was always, so you shifted this whole thing. But please tell me that there's been any character after Nzegazeka that has shifted the needle. None. There hasn't been any. There's
in South Africa, I understand.
There's attempts here and there,
yes.
But those, there are certain tricks and traits in radio that never will date. You know, you find a good character. I mean, Stan Cairns had the voice of God.
I remember.
You know?
I remember the voice of God.
I mean, the voice of God would come from nowhere and they call him to order. He would do something silly and the voice of God will call him to order, you know?
I mean, but Wicked has those prank calls.
Exactly.
Yeah, those prank
calls. You know
calls
what I mean?
Well, yeah.
Jeremy had Simpi with the taxi driver.
Yeah, you know?
But Nzegazeka was, you could relate. So radio has done exactly what it's been doing over the years. Find a new way and then let behind. And then other media types have to drag it through, you know? And maybe that's intrinsically what it is. It'll always lag behind a little bit and it'll be yanked to fall in line and be great again. But die, it will never.
Your most amazing radio moments, my most memorable one, and I'd say the most amazing, was when I think his name was Kabelo, I forgot his name. Kabelo Tibedi, I think. He walked into the Home Affairs with a toy gun and there was a hostage situation. I was live on air on my drive show, afternoon drive show at YFM. He called me. He asked them to get a phone and call me. I think he was one of my listeners.
Yeah.
Because he was a young guy.
Wow.
He was frustrated for not getting his ID.
I remember that story.
Out loud. Remember that story?
I remember that story very well.
Yeah. And I had to play the negotiator live on air because we didn't know that that was a toy gun. I thought somebody might get shot or he might get shot by the police. I'm on air. People are listening.
Those are one
of the most memorable radio moments of mine. What are yours?
Mine was on the 10th of April, just before the elections. There was this really forgettable racist character who worked for the SABC. He was the news compiler. So you see, before liberation, white people compiled the news and then black people read them. So it was on a Saturday and his name is Mike Kelly. I don't give a. So Mike Kelly wrote this article, the news, and he normally just dropped the copy, you know, for the newsreader. This one day he came in and he was red, like pink, all sorts of pink hues of red and pink and whatever. And he said, I was on the countdown. He said, Chris Hani's just been killed.
Oh. Bang.
You know, it was, what do you do? Mm. I had never been trained for this sort of thing.
And you're on air.
And I'm on air. And this is a countdown. This is like a, you know, a hip and happening show, you know?
And I had to bring the country's mood down.
Absolutely.
Chris Hani was, at the time, the whole country adored him.
Yeah, this was a president in waiting.
Yeah, he was a president in waiting.
And I had to do what I had to do, you know? I had to break the news and just, you know, find a song to play that epitomized that moment. And it was, of all the moments I've had on radio, that one stands out for me, because from that, I then became friends with his wife. And during the time leading up to the funeral, I was actually called by the deputy president at the time and his wife, Mamzanele and TM, to distract the kids. So they were my fans watching Studio Mix, Mulindi, you know, and I had to entertain them and be their friend, you know. So it that is the one moment that stands out for me when you think about radio moments. The lousiest one was when I cost my radio station about 40K. This was back at Radio Bop. We had to record our shows.
Yeah.
But there was nothing digital. Everything was analog. So there was something called a patch field where you had to actually patch the jacks.
Yeah, it was analog. I remember that.
And I remembered during the show that I had to record for, I mean, we used to be air checked every day on Radio Bop. Every day, when you knock off, you get air checked. When you come in, they check your prep. And then that is why most guys who started at Radio Bob, most of them are still with it right now.
Yeah.
So I missed the live feed. I disconnected the radio station.
Yo, and then you went dead air.
Unfortunately, there was no social media back then. Yeah. And the station manager and everyone else were in a board meeting. So they didn't know the station was off for about 20 minutes.
Sure. And that's a fireable,
I mean, I'm going,
a fireable offense.
It is, you know. I was going on air. There was nothing happening.
Oh, you were not aware?
I was not. Nobody was aware. Everybody was going on about their business. And it was only when one of the engineers tried to monitor and was like, oh my goodness, we're off air. But they didn't know for how long until there was a recon. And it was like, geez, 20K? I wasn't even earning half that.
At that time.
Yeah.
You see, I need a part two with them because I've just had to focus on the story. And the story still does not have those other stories that I'd like for him to share even more. Because as an artist, as a DJ, as somebody who's in the entertainment industry, you'd know. Being a peer with other artists, other DJs, there's just so many stories that I'd like to hear from him. There's so many other things that I'd like to speak to him about. There's politics that I'd like for us to get into. He's involved with a black radio station right now. And I want us to have that conversation on a high level where most countries, you find that the white supremacist system will always make sure they own the media so that they're always able to set the narrative to society, or to be able to, you know, program or brainwash society to say whatever they want to say, or whenever they wanted to control people, whether through print media, through television, radio, etc. Those type of talks that I'd like to have with him. I know we've been talking for about an hour. And we are both radio people, so we can go on the whole time. But the ladies that are behind the camera, they're like smooth at the time. So we'd really love to have you again, you know?
Absolutely, it'd be my pleasure. It'd be my pleasure. And next time I'll come in a t-shirt, you have more fire. So it's all good. But I got meetings to go to.
Before I let you go, I know you got meetings as well. Maybe straight to the camera. I'd like for you to speak to Bob Mabena, a 65-year-old or a 70-year-old Bob Mabena. This is you 2-3 decades from now.
Wow.
We're going to send you this tape. Because 20 years, 30 years goes like this.
Wow,
speak
man.
Speak to yourself there. And you need to remember, there you are surrounded by your kids and your grandkids. And we're going to send you this video. I'll be an old man as well. I'll be gray. I'll be like, Khurban, do you remember this interview?
Wow, man. That's nice. Well.
What would you like to say to yourself and your kids?
Sure.
And grandkids.
I am in a place where I'm reinventing myself as we speak. I'm 50 years old as we speak now. So I'm, you know, I'm planning something entirely different from what I'm doing right now. It's gonna put you in the house that you are in right now and give you all the fortunes that you have right now. And it's got nothing to do with radio and television, but it's going to be absolutely fantastic. And I hope that you're enjoying it as we speak right now. And thanks to Sbu for that, because It's right here, man. It's right here. Thank you.
He remains an inspiration to a lot of us. I'm his biggest fan, and I think I'm one of the lucky few guys to have had a chance to, you know, sit and dine with my role model and to get the love back from him, because even before he knew that he was my role model, he showed me love. He showed me so much love, and I was like, wow, he recognizes me. And then I think with the growth of my career, you just like me, you took a liking to me.
Yeah.
And I didn't understand why, because I never thought that would happen. And I think for me, that was a real dream come true. And I think for that generation that you inspired, I'm sure you're also proud of the work that I've been able to do.
Oh, absolutely. You know, Sbu, it's opportunity is a fleeting moment. And the man upstairs doesn't look at us in terms of day and night. We're all like on a flat line like this. And it starts here and it ends here. You're born and then you pass on. I think our inability to look at it that way makes us think that tomorrow is a given, you know? But I think you've had the ability to look at it and think, this is not gonna last that long. I better do something about this now. And you see, the more you do that, the more you get excited about stuff.
You know?
I've never seen anyone as excited as you are.
Yes,
you know what I mean?
Mm.
And it's not excitement out of just euphoria. It's excitement out of living in the moment and precipitating the next moment.
Mm.
And that's what I like about you. The fact that, you know, the moment is the moment. Yeah, that's cool. But this moment is a springboard to the next moment and the next. And so you build without even, you sweat, but the sweat is so worth it. And it's not like, you know what I mean? You're having fun. And while you're having fun and creating, it's that straight line. You know, at some stage it's going to end, but that doesn't stop you from getting it as much as you can. And that's the magic. That's the magic of hustling.
Thank you. And I hope all the hustlers out there, you guys are inspired, especially hustlers that are trying to get into the entertainment industry. Doesn't matter, TV acting, whether music producing, DJing, dancing, whatever it is. And shout out to all the other hustlers who are selling products, running businesses, or wanting to get into business. And all of those rest of the other hustlers who are students and those that are climbing the corporate ladder. We hope today's episode really inspired you to also navigate your career in ways that are better than what we've done, in ways that are even on a higher level than what he was able to do in apartheid South Africa. He remains one of the most biggest names in this country. Radio genius is what we call him. He's done everything we can ever think of in the entertainment industry. He's been a trendsetter all these years. He's broken boundaries and he's still here and he still looks 35. You know, the jam. Guys, he DJs, he does voiceovers, he's on air. He's an entrepreneur, he's a father, he's a family man. He's a role model, like he's just everything. And Bop Mabena, thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
Much appreciated, man.
I can go on, guys. You can tell I'm a big fan. People are doing great things with their lives out there, guys. There's no wasting time. Stop procrastinating. And before I let you go, the last thing I'd like for you to say is just a message of advice and encouragement to my hustlers out there.
It's something I've said before and I want to say it again. Opportunity can be a fleeting moment. When you want to get something done, you need to say it as often as possible. You need to visualize it, because sometimes we wish for stuff, but we're not in the moment. We're not present in wishing for that stuff. And when it comes, you miss it. And then you're gonna think, namapati, you know, God doesn't like me or anything like that. You wish for something, speak it, visualize it, because when it comes, it's not gonna come wrapped up in a ribbon. It will probably sometimes even hit you in the back of your head and give you a bruise. But opportunities will always come. That's for sure. And that's when you grab them and you move with it onto the next thing, to the next thing, to the next thing. It never stops. It just keeps going like a straight line like that. You gotta grab it.
Thank you, guys. Have a great one. Yeah. Share the video, tell your friends about it, and subscribe to the channel. I'll see you on the next episode. This has been The Hustler's Corner.
Hi, I'm Bop Mabena, husband, father, grandfather, station manager, Power, and also host of Power Breakfast. I've just been hassled by DJ Sbu on The Hustler's Corner. Loved it.